important financial accounting standard. This standard has been in the system for quite some time now. That is property, plant, and equipment, that is IAS system. Although several standard graph that is now been established by the IAS board have been revised by the Ifrs Foundation, this particular one, I think, has met all the recognition that is appropriate for accounting for PPE. Therefore, it has not been revised, and they still apply it in the accounting treatment for property, plant, and equipment. So today we are going to discuss what it is, the requirements for which an entity is supposed to meet before accounting for its PPEs or its items under what PPE. Okay, so without wasting too much time, when we take any standard, as we all know, we pass it through the processes, establishing the scope, the definition, and then at the end, looking at how we initially measure it, and then how we subsequently measure it, and we recognize before the disclosure. So that's basically what we are going to do in this particular accounting standard. Now, when we say PPE IAS 16, the standard has defined PPE to be a tangible item that is held in the business for the following purposes. So anytime we are looking at PPE, we are saying that it is a tangible item held in the business for one, the production or delivery of goods and services. That is one. The second one is that for administrative purposes, or the last one is that for rental to others. So we are saying that it is a tangible item used in the business for production and delivery of goods and services. The second one for rental purposes, and then the last one for administrative purposes, and of which it is expected of that item to remain in the business for more than one accounting period. Very, very important. This, the last sentence, distinguish an item of PPE from inventory. You know, inventories are supposed to remain in the business within one accounting period. But when it comes to PPE, they are supposed to be in the business and the benefit is supposed to be enjoyed for more than one accounting period. So according to the standard, when we say PPE, we are saying that it is a tangible item that is held in the business for the production or delivery of goods, or for rental to others, or for administrative purposes, and from which the benefit is expected to be enjoyed by the business for more than one accounting period. That is the definition of what PPE. Now let's look at recognition. When should an entity, a company, recognize an item of PPE in its books? So we are looking at the recognition. When should you recognize PPE? So we've established the definition. So we want to look at the recognition. Now when we are saying recognition, we are saying that anytime the PPE, the benefits that accrue from the PPE will be enjoyed by the business, and those benefits or those economic benefits will be measured reliably, then we should recognize an item of what PPE. So here we are not looking at the definition of what the PPE, but when. First of all, the economic benefits will be enjoyed by the business, and then the second one is that those economic benefits can be measured reliably. Then we say that we can recognize PPE in the books of account. So now that we know when to recognize an item of PPE, let's look at the measurement. When it comes to IAS 16, the basic or the important aspect is measurement, especially the subsequent measurement. But before we go to the subsequent measurement, let's focus our attention, or let's focus on what the initial measurement. Now, when a company want to initially measure its PPE or its item of property, plant, and equipment, the standard says that it should initially be measured at cost. So initial measurement, PPE should be measured at what? At cost. PPE should be measured at cost. What does it mean? We say that cost, what the definition of cost? Cost, we say, are the cash and cash equivalent that is like considered to be a consideration under a particular contract or a transaction. Is that okay? But in this case, we are looking at cost to be a cash and cash equivalent. So the initial measurement should be what? The cash and cash equivalent received at the acquisition date or at the period which the asset was acquired. So the acquisition date, all the cost that you incurred should form part of what? The cost of what? Acquisition of the property. Now, the standard has given us the guidelines for the element of cost. What are some of the items that constitute costs? So our focus is going to be how to determine the cost of a PPE. We know that at the initial measurement, an item, a property, plant and equipment is supposed to be measured at what? At cost. But how do you determine the cost? So let's look at the element of what? Cost. So the element, the property, the standard has given us the element, the item that constitutes what? Cost. So we are focusing on the element of what? Cost. The element of cost comprises three categories of what? Expenses. Or three categories of what? Costs. The first one is the purchase price. The purchase price of what? The PPE or the purchase price of the item. Then we less trade discount. You will deduct trade discount from the purchase price. And then you add non-refundable tax. So N, non-refundable tax. And then we also add our import tax. So we are looking at the elements, the things that constitute the cost, because we know that an item of PPE is supposed to be initially measured at what? At cost. But what are the items that constitute the cost? We are saying they are categorized into three. The first one, we are looking at the purchase price. But this purchase price, when you take it, you are supposed to net, it should be the net of what? Trade discount. And it should also, if there is an import tax in that particular transaction, it should what? Add it. And if there is any tax that is non-refundable tax, it should be added. That is the first category. Now let's look at the second category. The second category are all other costs that are directly attributed to the acquisition or construction of the asset or the PPE. So we are saying that all costs directly attributable. So all costs that is directly attributable to the acquisition or construction of what? Of the asset. So we can look at series of them. We can look at the direct expenses that the entity incurs in transferring the asset from its, location of transaction to the business location. So we can look at what delivery costs, because it is directly what attributed to what? To the purchase of the item. So the first one can be what delivery costs. We can look at professional fees. We can look at carriage inward, a direct, the amount, the wages you pay to the employees that unpack the item from the vehicle. So carriage inward should be packed. Carriage inward. We can also talk of installation costs. Installation costs. All the, the expenses that you incur in getting the assets ready for use. So all costs that is directly related to the purchase or acquisition of the asset and bringing the assets to its present location until what it is ready for its intended use. All those costs are supposed to be capitalized or captured. So we can look at installation costs. We can also look at testing costs. But testing costs should be less okay, should be less of the value of proceeds or the value of item that you produce during the testing period. So what it simply means is that when you are testing the item and you produce an element of inventory, the value of that inventory should be less from what the testing cost. You look at an example and you see how you treated that particular item. So testing cost, net of what the value of the inventory you produce during the testing period. So during the testing period, so the value of the inventory you produce during the testing period. So, and any other cost that is directly related to bringing the asset to its present location and making the asset ready for what it intended use. You can also look at what site clearing cost. Site clearing cost. So site clearing cost, you can also look at that to be part of the site clearing cost. Is that okay? So, and the rest. So after doing the examples, if anyone comes across it, then you look at it. The next category is going to be the last one for that matter. The estimated cost of what dismantling or uninstalling the asset from your premises. Sometimes it is required of law, it is an obligation on the entity to dismantle or to remove the asset from its location when they have exhausted its useful life. So therefore, if there's an estimation, because they don't know. So anytime there's an estimation of what or dismantle or decommissioning of the asset, the value that you incur in re-preparing the site, restoring the site, returning the site to its original state, that particular estimated cost should be capitalized as part of the cost of what an asset. So that is dismantle, in other words, that's dismantle cost. So these are the three categories under which you are supposed to consider when you are trying to establish the cost of an asset. Remember that we said an item of PPE is supposed to be measured at initial cost, but what comprising the cost? We are saying all those things here comprising the cost. Some you are supposed to what? To less. Right, so we've defined what a PPE is, but we didn't give an example. So an example of PPE can be, we can look at land, we can look at building, we can look at plants and machinery. We can also look at vehicle and the rest, features and fittings. They are all what an example of what PPE. Any tangible asset that will be used in the business for whether administrative purposes, for production purposes, and for any what for rental purposes, and will be used in the business for more than one accounting period, should form part of what or should be categorized as what PPE. Now, what are some of the costs or expenses that does not take part or that are not form part of the cost of an element of what? PPE. So things that are not supposed to be part of the cost. Any administrative or overhead cost is not supposed to be capitalized as part of the cost of what? An element. For instance, overhead cost, administrative expenses. You have so if any of those expenses are incurred at the acquisition date, those expenses should be treated directly in your P&L account, profit or loss account, but should not form part of the cost of the asset. So any cost that is not directly associated with the acquisition and bringing the asset to its present location, those costs should be capitalized as what expense in the P&L account, but should not be captured as part of the cost of the asset. Very, very important. So let's take note of that. So the question on the screen, let's solve the question on the screen. So we have RONAS Enterprise undertaking some acquisition. So that's the question. So the first one, what will be the cost? We should determine the cost of the plant at the end of the period. So remember that, let's say we are determining the cost. What value should we capitalize as our initial measurement or as the cost of the item on the book or in the books of what RONAS? So the first one, remember that is the purchase price. So we have our purchase price. So our purchase price. Remember that our purchase price, there's a discount given in the question. Okay, there's a trade discount. So we are going to let that trade discount. So we have the purchase price to be what? 1 million. So we have 1 million. 1 million less 50,000. So this will give us 950. So we are trying to determine the cost of what the plant is out here. What else should we bring? What are the directly attributable costs? So let's take one by one.
Delivery cost, yes, delivery cost, it was part of it.
So delivery cost will come, which is what? 100,000. We also have installation cost, yes. Installation cost is supposed to form part of the cost of the assets. So with installation cost, which is also 155,000. We also have architect fees. Remember, professional fees, architect fees is part of it. So we also capitalize architect fees to be what? Part of it. Architect fees. And then the amount is how much? The amount is 15,000. And then we also have the cost of what? Preparing the site. Remember, all those expenses that are directly related to what? The preparation of the site to get the asset ready for its intended use is supposed to be capitalized. So the cost of preparing the site should be capitalized as part of it. So cost of preparing the site. Cost of preparing the site. How much is it? That is 200,000. It's also supposed to be captured. And then we also have the testing. Testing of what? The asset. Testing of the asset. Okay. The call that we incur. Remember the testing what costs. So, but remember that when we are testing the asset and we make any production of an inventory, the value of that inventory is supposed to be deducted from all the testing before we add it to it. So, therefore, we have testing cost. Test cost. The amount is 75,000. But if you look at the additional information, the question or the screen, additional information, let's look at that question. If you look at it, they said they made a value of 10,000 when during the testing period. So, that 10,000 is supposed to be next of the 75,000. So 10,000. So here we are going to have 65,000. And remember, if you look at the information provided, they said there's a what? A decommissioning what cost. Because the item, there's an estimation that the item will be removed from each site at the end of the period. Therefore, the decommissioning or the dismantling cost should be added to what? To the cost of the asset. So which is 250,000. That would be a dismantling cost or decommissioning cost. So, dismantle cost or decommissioning cost. So, what's the cost? What the total? We are going to get 170,500 to be our cost of assets to be capitalized in the books of what? RONAS. So, initially, we are supposed to treat, is it 170? I think it's 1,705,000. So 1,705,000, that is supposed to be the value of what our asset that we are supposed to capitalize in the books. Now let's look at other issues pertaining to what initial measurement when it comes to what to cost. So subsequent expenses. These are subsequent measurement, subsequent what? Expenses. Subsequent expenditure. Subsequent expenditure. Now, the general rule is that if that subsequent expenditure, okay, the general rule is that if it is repairs and maintenance, you know, repairs and maintenance is supposed to be treated in a P or L account straight away. So if it's repairs and maintenance of an item of what we have initially recognized it, then that expense should be treated in what the P&L account as an what as an expense. But if that subsequent expenditure will improve, so two things: if it will improve the useful life of the asset, then that replacement or repairs should be capitalized as part of the cost of what the asset. So if the repairs will improve the useful life or the economic benefit that is being derived from the asset, then that particular asset is supposed to be what? Capitalized as what? Capitalized as part of the cost of the asset. Another one is about replacement. If we are replacing a major component of the asset, that means we are replacing a major component of the asset, then that replacement should, the cost of that replacement should form part of the cost of our asset. But if we are going to dispose of what you are replacing, then the part that you are replacing should be what disposed of, should be taken off from the books of account. What that is what it simply means. It should be what taken off from the books of account, provided we are taking that part off. But if it's an addition of a part that we are adding to the asset, then that cost should be capitalized as addition to what the already cost of the asset. So please remember, if it is repairs and maintenance, that the general will treat that amount as what expense in the POL. But if it is, so that repairs or that replacement is supposed to improve, or the replacement is a major part, it is of a significant value, then that particular asset is supposed to what? To be part or capitalized as part of the cost of what? The asset. Another issue is about inspection. So assets that are inspected, inspection of what assets. If it is required by law that an entity should operate or take into consideration an asset that will be, you know, inspected, then inspection cost, or for the cost of inspecting the asset, is supposed to be capitalized as part of what the cost of what the asset. Please always remember that. So all that we discussed about is what about the initial measurement of the asset, that is what costs. All right, so we are going to focus our attention on what subsequent measurement now. So we are now with what costs. The what they are supposed to do is subsequent measurement, the subsequent expenditure, that is repairs and maintenance, and all the elements that constitute what the cost, how to establish the cost of what the asset. So that will be the next focus, is going to be the subsequent measurement. We are now with what the initial measurement. So when it comes to subsequent measurement of an item of PPE, so we are looking at now subsequent measurements. So when it comes to subsequent measurement of an item of PPE, then what we are supposed to take into consideration, or what the standard has prescribed, is that an item of PPE can either be subsequently measured at cost, or at cost model or revaluation model. It depends on the entity to select or choose which of the model the entity would be able or would like to what remeasure its what item of PPE. So we have subsequent measurement, we have two models, we have the cost model, and then we have the what revaluation model. So let's focus on the cost model. The cost model simply means that you will take the cost of the PPE. For instance, if you are looking at motor vehicle, or even the plan that we have calculated, and then we are saying that the cost is 175. This is the cost. And if you are in the cost model, we just subsequently what? Depreciate the value of the asset over its useful life. That is just about what? The cost model. Remember that when it comes to this particular model, date becomes something of essence. An essential thing that we are always supposed to focus on is the date, especially when you are dealing with the cost model and also the revaluation model. The date is very, very important. And then the cost that will always come. Sometimes depreciation will just be a full year, whether you are buying the asset in the middle or not, you are going to calculate your depreciation for a full year. So the cost model always, we just take the cost of the asset, depreciate it over each useful life. What it simply means is that you will depreciate the asset, and we know what depreciation is. You know, depreciation is what is allocating the cost or our expenses at the cost of what? By what? Matching the cost of the asset to the benefit derived through what ownership, that is depreciation. And we also know that we are supposed to what? Know the residual value, and then the depreciable amount. Depreciable amount is the amount of the asset or amount that is substituted less the residual value. The residual value, we know that it is the what? Estimated money or the estimated amount that the entity will currently obtain from disposal of the asset, less any what disposal cost. Less any disposable cost. That is what residual value. Residual value is an estimated amount of an asset through its disposal. So when you they have exhausted the use of what the asset, when you are disposing it off, the value that you have estimated, less any money that you incur in disposing it off, that one will give you what your residual value. So in calculating the depreciation for the particular plant, you still are looking at the cost model. The most important thing is that you depreciate the asset over its useful life, which comes with less what complication. So in this case, if you are, the useful life of the asset is maybe 15 years, then we depreciate the asset over what the useful life of 15 years, depending on what the depreciation method that is adapted by the business. So you may decide to adapt the straight line method, the reducing balance method, or end of year digit method, or the production unit method, any of the method that you deem appropriate, you will use that. But for the purpose of examination, and you know, you are supposed to use what probably you will be prescribed or be required to use the first two methods, which is the reducing balance or the straight line method. That is about what cost model. So therefore, at the end of each period, you will have to establish the carrying amount of the assets. We have to know the accumulated depreciation. You have to know. So if you want to get the carrying amount of the assets, the accumulated depreciation is going to be the cost of the assets. The cost of the assets less the accumulated depreciation of the assets will give you the carrying amount. This is the carrying amount. Or the carry, if you want to get the new or the present carrying amount, it is the current amount, the previous carrying amount less the current depreciation will give you what is the new carrying amount. But if you don't want to be confused, just go by the cost, by what less all the accumulated depreciation. Accumulated depreciation is adding the total depreciation together, the total year depreciation together. So if it's 2 years, you add a 2 year depreciation together, less from the cost will give you the carrying amount. That is the issue about what? About cost. Remember that the depreciation, the yearly depreciation will be treated in your P&L account, and then the current amount will be the remaining value of the asset in your statement of financial position. So that is it about cost model. So now let's focus on the revaluation model, still on the subsequent measurement. So revaluation model. So with the revaluation model, at the end of a period or when an item is revalued, the figures will be provided for you. Okay, so you'll be getting a revalue figure. There are two ways an asset can be revalued. It's either we revalue the asset upward or we revalue the asset what? Downward. When we revalue the asset upward, the treatment is different from when we revalue the asset downward. Is that right? So assuming, let's use the example, assuming that our plant initially cost 100 cedis, and then at the end of the period, we were told that the asset is revalued to 130 cedis. So this is an upward what? An upward revaluation. So how do you treat the difference of the 30? So anytime there's revaluation, it's either the entity is incurring revaluation loss or revaluation gain, depending on whether the revaluation is upward or downward. So the question or the statement will inform you whether there's what the revaluation is what downward or upward. So if this is upward revaluation, then the carrying amount of the assets in the financial statement will now be 130. So you will change the previous one to 130 in the statement of financial position with 130. And then the difference here, which is what? Revaluation what? Gain. So the previous carrying amount was 100, but the new one is what? 130 because of what? Upward revaluation. So the revaluation gain is going to be the 130. The revaluation amount minus what the carrying amount, which is what 100, which will give us what 30. This 30 is credited to our other comprehensive income, the OCI. Remember that revaluation gain is always treated in the other comprehensive income. Assuming that at the end of the period, we were told that the asset now is revalued to what 90,000. If the asset is now revalued to 90,000, but the carrying amount of the asset is 100, then this is what a downward revaluation. So this one will lead to the what we call revaluation loss, because you are going to have 90 minus 20 equal to give us for negative or a loss of what, 10. Anytime there is revaluation loss, the loss is supposed to be treated in the P or L account. Remember, revaluation gain will go to what? Revaluation gain will go to the other comprehensive income. A revaluation loss will be treated in the P or L account as what? A loss or as an expense. But the issue comes when we are having an opening revaluation what? Gain. So if already in account of the entity there is a revaluation gain, and then the entity is incurring revaluation loss, you will first net off the loss and if there is any difference before you send a difference to what? The P or L account. What does it mean? If previously the opening revaluation gain is 5 cents in the books already and we are incurring a loss of 10, then you will go to the OCI of the company. You go to the OCI of the company and then net off the net the loss of 10. So that 5 year will be cancelled by that new 5 or 14. So we just go there and then debit the 5 that it will cancel the credit balance over here because it's a loss. So this will cancel. Then the next, the remaining loss will then be sent to the P or L account. If it is vice versa, there is a revaluation loss. You know, revaluation loss are always treated in the P or L account. So if there is a revaluation gain and there's a gain, now I'm just going to add it to it. So the question always comes when there is a gain and you are incurring a loss. So you should know that. And always take years into consideration. First of all, establish the current amount of the asset at the date that the revaluation is what is being incurred. So if you establish the current amount, the difference between the revaluation value and the current amount will tell you whether it is what revaluation gain or revaluation what loss. So if it's a gain, you know how to treat it, and if it is a loss, you know how to treat it. Another issue is when should revaluation be done? Revaluation should be done subsequently. I think at the end of every period, there should be revaluation. Remember that land and building are separate property, land and equipment. Land and building are separate what item together. So anytime you're given land and building, you're provided with the figures separately. Remember, land is not depreciated, but we revalue what land. Why? Because land is having an infinite years. It doesn't have a limitation in terms of what useful life. It's having an infinite what useful life. So we don't depreciate land, but we depreciate what building. So anytime you get a question in that, don't depreciate land, but revalue land in case the question or the statement demands for that. So that is just a brief summary about property, land, and equipment. Thank you.
Thank you for watching our video. Please don't forget to subscribe to our channel for more of such valuable content on all business-related courses.